All right. Hi, guys. I'm Jakob. And I am hopefully going to tell you how to predict anything in the future. Stock markets, IoT data, weather. Nah. Got your attention, but unfortunately, I can't even lay claim to that. But what I am going to show you is how to use LSTMs in a neural network approach to at least get a different understanding and get a maybe slightly better understanding in terms of using a time series approach rather than the more traditional kind of methods. So I'm just going to give a quick background about myself. As you already mentioned, my main kind of job is a quantitative research developer within a large global investment manager. I'm also an independent consultant for full-stack software development and a little bit of machine learning, etc. And I also like to hurl myself out of planes. So rather weird little mix of hobbies. But yeah, that's me. If you've got any questions on that later, I'll be more than happy to answer them. Now, a little bit of background. So this is my first kind of presentation here and meet up with you guys. I'm not an expert in IoT at all. I'm very new and naive to the field, and obviously I haven't met any of you guys either before, so I just want to get a quick show of hands just to kind of gauge where everyone's at. Who's, I'm guessing you all have, but who's heard of neural networks? Most, yeah, pretty much most of you. What about LSTMs? Yep, a couple. Okay, good.
So assume that people don't know LSTMs.
Yeah.
And assume that people know a little bit about neural networks, but not the detailed theory behind them.
Perfect. That's ideal. That's kind of what I was hoping for. If you were all experts in LSTMs, then this would be a little bit simple, but this is good. So I'm just going to give a kind of overview of... I'm going to give a 60-second overview for those of you who didn't raise their hands on kind of what neural networks are and how they work, kind of vanilla flavors. And then... of how LSTMs, which are a kind of extension to normal vanilla neural networks, kind of work. So in 60 seconds, neural networks, essentially they were developed quite a long time ago, kind of 70s, 80s, to essentially mimic the workings of the human brain. They work in the sense that you have stacked layers of neurons, and neurons are essentially just activation functions, the most simple of which it's just a sign activation function, and it's combined with a weight that takes the input, multiplies it by a weight, and then if that triggers the activation function, produces an output. And large numbers of neurons stacked in layers can produce quite fun behaviors, as I'm sure you know. It can be used for all sorts of things, and a lot of the kind of deep learning and machine learning approaches used these days to do really crazy and awesome things using variants of the traditional neural networks that were predicted, that were made back in the 70s and 80s. So the issue with actual normal neural networks, especially on a time series approach, and especially applicable, I'm guessing, to IoT, because a lot of IoT data is kind of sequential time series type data, is that they have a distinct lack of memory. They can't remember. Now, this obviously poses an issue, because if you're looking at sequential data, then having each input or each set of inputs as completely fresh inputs without a history of the past poses a little bit of a challenge. Now, you might think, okay, so the most simple way to introduce memory into these kind of networks would be to just use a feedback loop, right? And that is what people did do in the past, and that's what, where recurrent neural networks, or RNNs, first came about. Essentially, an RNN is the neuron, like a standard vanilla neuron, but the output is also then fed back into the input of the neuron again, giving some term of memory to that neuron, which is all well and good, but RNNs do suffer from one kind of big drawback, and that is something called vanishing gradient problem. Essentially, these neurons usually have a sine or a tan H activation function, and if the output, which is between 0 and 1 or minus 1 and 1, keeps getting multiplied, say by even by something very slightly smaller than one, the output will get very, very small very, very quickly. So naturally that reduces the learning rate of the network itself pretty quickly to an indistinguishable amount, and kind of renders them a little bit useless. Luckily, I think around about 2006-07, some guys from Switzerland invented LSTMs. Now, LSTM stand for long short-term memory neural networks, and they're essentially a kind of iteration on RNNs that get rid of the vanishing gradient problem through a clever trickery that I'm going to talk to you about. So LSTMs, or LSTM neurons, which you can kind of see here, behave a little bit differently in the sense that they're actually made up of four neural network neurons inside of the, well, let's call them modules rather than neurons themselves, the LSTM modules.
So I guess what they're saying is that what was a neuron in a traditional neural network now comprises of four.
Exactly.
Inside one.
Four functions inside one. Yeah, exactly. So traditionally, it was just one activation function. You got the inputs. The input was then taken through the activation function, and if it was activated, an output was spat out. Now we have these four activation functions, essentially four neurons in there, as well as some what looks like confusing arrows, strange pathways. But they essentially act as gates. And the main idea behind an LSTM module is this little long line across the top, which is the module state. Now, the module state allows the LSTM modules to keep a long-term memory, well, both a long and a short-term memory, as the name suggests, of the whole network. And what these gates essentially do, I'm not going to go into the complexities of them, but essentially what these gates do is they take the input, XT, and they decide how much of that input should be used to update the module state, if any at all. So, so for example, this first gate here, you can see that there's three sigmoid gates and one tanh gate there. The sigmoid ones essentially say how much of that input should be used to update the module state. If it's zero, you know, it doesn't update anything. If it's one, it updates the whole module state and anything in between. And the implementations do differ. That's the one thing I have to say. LSTMs, although the core idea behind an LSTM module is roughly the same. They all roughly have, in fact, they all have four kind of gates. The actual placement of the arrows differs depending on what research paper you read. So you might see very slightly tweaked implementations of these, but in essence, they do the same thing. They update a module state, and it allows the neurons to keep a good long-term memory of what's going on, essentially. Now, the best way to actually, I guess, show you this and show you what you can do with it is to show you an example. So a super simple example here would be to model a sine wave function. A sine wave function is pretty great. It's a recurring pattern. Now a traditional neural network obviously would struggle because it wouldn't have that history. If it just got shown a window, it wouldn't have that history to be able to map the whole function. But I'm hopefully going to explain how an LSTM goes through that. So what we have here, we've got a sine wave, and we've got the data points of that sine wave in a CSV file, 5001 time periods, and we are going to split those into, it's a standard kind of data science example, split it into a training set and a testing set, 90 to 10, and our training set is going to be windows of 50. They're going to be progressing windows, so sliding along by one each time. And an example of a window would be something like that. So this is what gets fed into the network state at each time period. The network just sees these kind of snippets of the sine wave. It doesn't see the whole thing. It just sees little zoomed in versions. And from that, it has to extrapolate on once it learns the weights, it has to extrapolate on what it thinks the next predictions are given a set of windows. So how you then do that? Quick show of hands as well. Who uses Python here? Quite a few people. Awesome. Cool. So the code that I'm going to show you a bit later on is Python code, and although it uses a TensorFlow backend, I use an additional library on top of that called Keras, which is very, very nice. Essentially, it's almost as simple as stacking Lego bricks, but with neural networks and LSTMs, and it makes it really quick and really simple to actually produce these models really quickly. How you actually load this data into an LSTM network or the network is you load it into a three-dimensional array. So the dimensions, the first part is the total windows, 4,500 or something, obviously, training windows. The second part is the window size, so 50. And the third part, for this particular case, is just one. And that's essentially the dimensionality of the data. Obviously, we only have the one-dimensional data here. However, the good thing with LSTMs, as with normal neural networks, is you can have many input dimensions to them. So you can have multi-dimensional time series sequential inputs, which is really gives it a kind of more powerful feel to it. Go for it.
Sorry, quick yeah. One. Is that something that is optimizable, the window size, or is that something we'll have to specify?
Obviously you can optimize the process yourself by trying different window sizes and seeing which ones work the best, etc. I've just used the length of 50 because, just a hand in the air kind of thing. No reason. I don't know if it's the best window size for this. I didn't really have time to try a different optimization method. But as with all hyperparameters, you can see which ones are optimized for the best results for your particular problem. Yeah.
Give us some examples of this multi-dimensional.
Yeah, so essentially, as with normal neural networks, you can have one input into the whole network. You have many inputs, essentially a multi-dimensional input. The same can apply to LSTMs. So just because you have a window of length 50, that is actually only treated as an input size of 1. Because it's only one dimension. The length is 50, but it's only one dimension because you're only giving one dimension of input, essentially. So, for example, if you had, a stock market, you could specify multiple dimensions along that sequence. So you have a time sequence of price returns, volatility, volume. There's three dimensions that you could all bunch up at each specific time period, and you could add that into the network as well to hopefully give you better predictions. Yeah.
So they're really variables.
Like, sorry?
Say if you were, say it was medical data.
Yeah.
Sensors. It could be somebody's heart rate, blood pressure.
Yes, absolutely.
Variables.
Exactly. Yeah. So you could use as many variables as you want. Obviously, the more variables you use, especially on a network like this, it's going to really exponentially increase the time it takes to train the network. So you might have to look at playing with dimensionality reduction. But blood pressure, heart rate, add many variables to it, which really gives it room for kind of good potential use cases, I feel. So moving on to the actual prediction of this particular sine wave, the network I actually used is you've got one input one dimension of size 50 windows. Then you've got two hidden layers. Again, as per a completely normal neural network, you've got just hidden layers, and the LSTM modules are treated essentially as normal neurons now. So I've got two hidden layers of size 50 LSTM modules and a second one of size 100 LSTM modules. And then in the end, that feeds into just one single normal output neural network neuron with a linear activation function. That essentially then predicts what it thinks the output should be, the next part of that sequence should be. So in this case, what the next part of the sine wave data should be. And if we take a look down here, so this is actually the model that I've run. The blue is the true data, the green is the prediction. And this is just after one run through, one epoch, one training run of the whole model. And you can see it does actually pretty good. There's a little bit of a shift in frequency here, where it hasn't quite learned the frequency of the sine function. But other than that, I mean, the scale is almost there. You can't really see it, but it's a little bit off on the scale. But essentially, it's learned the sine wave very well. It's learned the sine wave pattern really well, which is pretty good. And the way I've actually predicted this, rather than predicting on a step-by-step basis, where you initialize it and then you take a fresh set of testing data and just keep predicting the next step. I've actually only initialized the testing window with the first 50 real-world testing sets, testing data sets, and then it's predicted the next one. And then the prediction has been appended to the end of that window. It's pushed the window along, and then it's predicted the next one and the next one and the next one. So after 50 time steps, because it's a window of size 50, it's actually predicting on the predictions, and so on and so forth. I'll go on a little bit in the next couple of slides about why you probably don't want to do that for more real-world data sets. But for now, it's predicting the next 500 steps, and you can see it's getting a little bit more and more out of phase as it goes on. But it's done pretty well.
So what you're saying here is the sine wave
mm-hmm.
is what we're trying to predict.
Exactly. Yes.
Does it map to the neural to the layers above? How does this? Because you have those two diagrams like that.
Yeah.
Is it that they are like a neural network? Each layer is trying to do something, or is it just a sliding window?
So the sliding window comes into the. That's the input. So the input is here, and that's fed into the network. So for each window, as it slides along, it gets fed as the input to the network. The network then has its learned weights for the sine function or for what it thinks is the sine function. And it takes the data from that window. So if we go back a few... it takes, say, this, and it goes, I see this shape. What do I reckon this point here is next? And because it's seen this shape many, many, many times, because it's trained on all of this data up to about here, it knows to a very, very high degree of certainty that, say, for this particular window, the data point is almost certainly here. So that's what it will predict.
So window size is
arbitrary? Well, yeah, you can specify it to whatever you want. Again,
in your example, you have just a window size of 50 because you're deciding to get 100 samples.
Because I decided to what? Sorry.
To get 100 step.
Yeah. I chose 50 completely just out of thin air, completely arbitrary. I didn't do any kind of optimization processes on. It wouldn't really matter on a sine wave, but again. On more real-world noisy data, you'd probably want to have some sort of optimization process to choose what the correct window size is. And it'll also apply to what you're hoping to achieve out of that real-world data. You're hoping to just predict the next time step, but you're hoping to predict the kind of momentum of the real-world data. But actually, funny enough, we'll go on to that now.
You decided the number of neurons you have on your first layer, according your window size?
No, and I did notice that just as I was speaking, that the second layer also has 50. I probably shouldn't have done that just because it might be a bit confusing. It's nothing to do with the window size.
Okay.
It's again just an arbitrary number that I chose, 50 and 100. It could have been a 60 and 120. Again, I haven't used an optimization process to get to cross-validate across different networks to see which one works best. But yeah, cool. So I think it's probably best if I show some real-world examples. So seeing as we're in IoT here, I got some data from a household smart meter, which predicted minute-by-minute energy usage of said particular households. And I think I got about a couple of 100,000 data points from that one, and trained on that. And essentially, I used the exact same model that I used for the sine wave. In fact, I think I used exactly the same one. The only difference I did was I normalized the input a little bit, because now we don't have a nice uniform between -1 and 1. Now we have noisy data that goes up and down by large increments, which neural networks don't particularly like, and the training kind of goes all funky if you don't normalize the data. So with the normalized data, I then just fed it through the same network, and as you can see, actually now you don't have, so the blue data, the blue line is naturally the true data, and the multicolored little ones are the predictions. And now they're not mapping exactly, well, as you'd expect, because the real world data isn't a nice function, it's not mapping to the real world data. What I have done is, you can see that they're all split up, there's many, many different little lines. I've made a function that predicts the window size, which that one is 80 steps ahead, and then refreshes, updates the next window with the real world data, and then tries to predict the next 80 steps, and then refreshes the real world data again. Because what I found, mentioning back to my earlier point, is if you try and go on predictions of predictions, naturally, if there's any kind of error in those predictions, that error is going to grow exponentially, and these predictions will go and converge to something silly. Yes.
That'd be funny, you've got no share prices.
Well, yeah. If well, yeah, that's with this graph actually. That the next real world example, this one, that's the S&P 500 index, and you can see the momentum of the predictions, especially for the high volatility parts of the graph, seems to indicate quite well that it's going, you know, that it's going to go up, and it has gone up, that it's going to go down, and it does go down. And I must admit, you know, when I first saw this, I did start looking at yachts and private jets. unfortunately, I then ran a few more tests and realized that this is, I wouldn't say a fluky window, but they're not quite as nice and consistent as this particular window that I happened to first test on. So, especially say here, you can see in the low volatility areas, it's not quite as accurate. It says it's going up, it goes all around the place. But then, that's an example with stock prices that I wouldn't expect, especially working in finance, especially with something like the S&P 500, a very efficient index. It's not something that I'd expect you could predict by just the price history. There's so much more going on in a stock market index that affects the price. But it's fun to look at, and it's fun to have a look and warn of the curse of A, overfitting, and B, getting fluky with your testing windows. So what I would always say and advise is, obviously, look at other ways to validate the network itself. But for certainly something that does have underlying patterns, such as energy usage or sensor data in IoT, where the sensor goes through seasonal changes, etc., that's something that could benefit from an LSTM being able to predict those patterns and being able to distinguish those.
Yeah, which is exactly why we are so interested with IoT and LSTMs. I mean, there's that aspect as well, because they do have patterns, and they do have repeating patterns under seasonal conditions, but also they have missing things as well. So there are patterns. For example, there is lots of IoT data which is noisy, missing sensors. Even the classic smart metering stuff, nobody expects it to be as consistent as anything else. You know, just if it misses values, it's fine.
Yeah.
And that's why something like this technique is extremely useful for IoT data. And also, one of the use cases, which I'm going to talk about afterwards, not fully, is when you don't have a lot of data. That's also the other reason why, because this whole sliding window thing allows you to get more granularity out of limited data sets.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm going to be actually really interested when we go and do some networking later on to just hear what your kind of use cases, or I'm sure all of you kind of have different ideas of your areas of speciality and your areas of expertise and how it could be applied over that. So again, me being a rookie to IoT and not knowing much about the field, it's very interesting to hear all the different areas where this could be applied. So it's very good.
If you say that's one day of energy usage and you assume that day two, day three, day four has similar patterns,
yeah.
Are you saying that on day two, three, four, the predictions would become better because it already knows
would be similar
pattern?
Yeah, exactly.
If it,
so
if it detects patterns which are similar, and
yes.
Therefore it trains itself to those patterns.
Exactly, yeah, exactly that. So and that's the whole point. If the patterns are similar, so if the, say, the daily usage or the monthly usage is similar, it's quite hard to distinguish that usage with a naked eye, A, because there's so many data points, and B, because there's so much noise. But if there really is an underlying pattern to it, hopefully the LSTM should, under the right hyperparameter settings, find that pattern. So on to the next slide. It is an ever-growing field, and there are LSTMs and RNNs aren't the only sequential neural networks. There's new stuff coming out: generative models, deep minds, differentiable neural computers, and something called progressive neural networks, which I haven't really looked that much into. But from what I have heard about them, they seem very promising. Again, everyone who kind of uses these right now, the big players, Google, etc., they're kind of keeping their cards close to their chest of how they're using them and quite how they work. So it's quite hard and a little bit overwhelming at times to just get all the literature on this. The way, obviously, the big players, Google, etc., use these is not just kind of on their own, but as part of a kind of very deep architecture. So they have lots of different networks, parts of it being LSTMs, parts of it being generative models, parts of it being normal vanilla neural networks for their particular application, whatever it may be, self-driving cars, etc. And these deep architectures then, obviously, when you have the hardware to train them, become immensely powerful. And I'm sure you've all heard crazy and awesome stories of how Google, etc., have been able to use these deep architectures to do crazy new things. But yeah, so that's a quick overview of just LSTMs.
So before like this statement, which
yeah.
is so true. Currently the unpopular brother of the neural network, for the sexy image recognition, etc., because that is so true.
Yeah.
Because at the moment, a lot of deep learning attention is going to image recognition, right? Whereas this is a little bit its unpopular cousin or step cousin, but for us, it's extremely important because of IoT data sets, because of any form of prediction with a time series, because
yeah.
almost stock markets and all that kind of stuff, everything comes under that. In fact, Joshua Bengio, who is one of the three guys who is connected with the deep learning stuff, and he's connected with me on LinkedIn, and I asked him this question about a year ago, and his book is excellent if you are trying to buy it. I've already pre-registered for it already at MIT Press Book. And he said the same thing as well, that this is like, it is not a problem, it's just that it is not a focus. It's just something, but for us, I think this is far more important than anything else. I'm glad you...
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I mean, it makes sense. If you look at people like to see the outputs and see real-world examples of the things that they do or the things that these things are capable of, and what's the best way to see outputs? And that's pictures, videos, labeling pictures, video analysis, and that's what convolutional neural networks are. And that's why they're so vastly popular. If you type in deep learning into Google, I'm sure the first 10 results will be convolutional neural networks. And you'll see very little about LSTMs because it's just quite hard to visualize, apart from on a time series graph, the effects of LSTM neural networks. On the other hand, the other thing that LSTM is obviously used for in a sequential manner, stuff like self-driving cars, is far too complex to get into. So convolutional neural networks kind of offer that halfway house between being simple enough to understand and not being a crazy deep architecture and something that people like you and me can implement without being Google, and can also see the results of, whilst, you know, the LSTMs, they're not, unless you're very interested in a specific field like IoT or financial time series data, it's not going to be as interesting and as applicable to you. So yeah, it's a good point. It's a good point.
So I have one observation, if I understood everything correctly. I can see a parallel between these long, short-term neural networks and the low-pass digital filters. Because, for example, obviously we are removing the noise from the input, something what digital filter actually does.
Mm-hmm.
I can see this, like in electronics we have digital filters for digital signals, and here we can use this basically to remove the noise from any kind of signal, real world signal, or data, which would be anything basically.
Yeah.
So it's a kind of filter, provided that obviously there are patterns. And actually in every signal, every data sequence, no matter how it looks, it can be actually divided into that Fourier series. I can't remember now, but basically the sum of some periodical signals, or periodical data. That's my observation.
It's a fair point, and yet it does in some aspects. It obviously does work as a filter, removing the noise and getting this, getting hopefully any kind of discernible patterns in there. One obvious place where I'm sure this probably surpasses the filters is the fact that this can do it on a multi-dimensional field. As I said earlier, if you've got, you know, you might not have a pattern just on a patient's heart rate or just on a patient's blood pressure, but actually combine heart rate, blood pressure, and a couple of other variables together over that time series, and there might be some sort of hidden multi-dimensional pattern in there that you physically couldn't visualize, but that the neural network can kind of tease out.
So such a time series, which has got multiple dimensions, like the heart rate, how would it look like? Would it be a combined wave for that, or would it be three separate things?
It would be three separate, if you're stripping out the individual individual factors, individual variables, essentially, it would be three separate things on the same time scale. So it has to have the same time series, naturally, but three very separate separate variables.
Three separate things, and they would be feeding into the LSTM
exactly
at the same time, and therefore you would see three different inputs.
Exactly. Yeah. So using the patient example again, if you've got blood pressure, heart rate, two variables over, starting from T0 to T50 at 1 minute samples, you would have to have those samples, you know, the same between the blood pressure and the heart rate. But yeah, then you could feed those uniformly into the network.
So basically, I think if a multi-dimension is trained separately, and then just at the end they were combined together.
They're not trained separately. They're trained as a whole of the network. The best way to look at this is, again, if you just look at a normal non-LSTM, normal vanilla neural network, the multi-dimensions are like the many different inputs. The many different inputs aren't trained separately as an individual input. They're fed into the network as a whole, as the N dimensions that form the network, and it's trained upon that. It's the same in LSTM neural networks. Each from the window, each time step of that window is fed into the network and trained on that. And if that time step has one dimension or five dimensions or N dimensions, it's trained on the dimensions as a whole.
Okay.
Awesome. All right. Yeah, as I said, I'm now going to quickly go through, for those of you who are interested, do a very quick code example in Python. Again, all this code is available on my GitHub, and I'm just going to go through the code that renders this, so you can see actually how simple using Keras is going to be. For the S&P 500 data, I have a single CSV file, S&P500.csv, and it just contains all the S&P closing prices from, as I said, I think 1st of January 2000 up until somewhere in mid-2016, prices on a single line. I've got two files, a run module and an LSTM class file. So the run file essentially just provides the main thread of execution for the whole thing, and the LSTM Python class essentially builds a network and transforms the data. The main execution thread for the run file and where everything gets done is this little snippet down here. So you can see here we define the sequence length, so of 50, that can be anything. The number of training epochs, which is 1 at the moment, but again, you can, hopefully to get it more accurate, you can optimize that to be any kind of training number that you want, and the theory is that the more you train, obviously the more accurate it'll be. Here we then load the training and testing data, so if we go to the actual LSTM class file, and I've defined a load data function here. It takes the file name, it takes a CSV, very simply just reads all that, it splits it up, it puts it into a long array, and then it transforms it into a NumPy array. So NumPy being the standard kind of vector mathematical library of Python, which that's what feeds into the Keras neural network model, and you're able to easily and quickly manipulate matrices and vectors within Python, within that library. Here I split it into a training and testing data set. Again, I just for this one I use a 90% training, 10% testing, mainly because I just want a small testing window. I don't want it too noisy or too big, so that I have to zoom in a lot. And what we do here is we reshape those NumPy arrays to be in those three dimensions. So the first dimension is the number of training windows. So so for example, in the sine wave, you've got the 5,000 data points, and you split that into 90%, about 4,500 training windows. The second dimension is the actual sequence size or window size, which I've defined at, was it 50? And then the third dimension, I've just put 1 because it's only single-dimensional data. But again, if we were dealing with more complex data sets, medical, you know, heart rate, blood pressure, etc., you could add those extra dimensions in there as well, which would be really, really good. And the one thing that I mentioned earlier, with the real-world data, you've just got to normalize it, because if you've got real-world data of crazy scales, the training is not going to handle that very well. So ideally, you want to kind of squash it down and normalize it to nice values, maybe between -1 and 1, 0 and 1, etc. And as for the windows themselves, I just normalized them from treated each window separately. So this is the key point. Each window is treated separately. It's the LSTM networks actually remember in the past, like all the windows in the past and all the patterns in the past, but the window itself is treated not sequentially to the windows that came directly before it. So you'll see down, I can't even, oh yeah, up here, should probably zoom in a little bit. Up here, I shuffle the actual training set, or the training windows, so they're not in sequence. The within the window itself, the sequence is there, but the windows themselves are not in sequence. that's why the window size actually does matter, and that's why you've got to do experiments and see what kind of window size really works for you, and optimize that to your liking. Then on down here, this is the kind of the meat of the actual of the code, and where Keras comes in, and this is how simple it is to build the LSTM network. That's all it is. 20 lines or so of code. You build the model, you add an LSTM layer. You don't even have to add an input layer because you just specify the input size and input dimensions. Add the two LSTM layers. I think, as I said, the top one is 50 LSTM modules, and the second one is 100 LSTM modules. And then you have this little dense layer here, which is just a single normal neuron from a neural network, completely interconnected to the LSTMs, and that's what then produces your prediction of, well, in this case, what it thinks the next price is going to be for the S&P 500. And with that, I've pretty much gone through the whole model. These, the predict point-by-point, predict sequence, etc., these functions are literally just to take the data and predict it. So actually, we'll only be using predict sequences multiple because that's what's applicable to the graph that I'm going to output. The two functions prior to that, because I use this this framework of code to do the sine wave as well. But essentially, we could delete these two functions and have well under 100 lines of code to do the whole model. And if we then run the model, you'll see, it's using TensorFlow, and you'll see how quickly, so it compiles in 0.2 of a second, and then give it a few more seconds, and now it's training on the one epoch on 3,500 samples, and you can see how quickly it kind of progresses along. Again, 3,500 samples, it's not that much, but even so, it's progressing on a, you know, not a powerful machine, it's a small laptop netbook, and it trains reasonably fast. Awesome.
Thank you very
much. Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.